sided with his family and the rest of the villagers. When the family discussed what to do, he pressured Kumsing to give up his faith in Jesus to preserve peace in their family and in the village. But Kumsing refused. Imagine if all of us were stuck in a dark well with clay and thorns in it. It would be uncomfortable, wouldn't it? Kumsing asked Calvin. What if one of us found a way out? Wouldn't everyone else be happy for them and try to get them out the same way too? Why don't you come out of the well into a wide, beautiful place where there's clean, amazing water? This is my life as a Christian. Kumsing's words caught Calvin by surprise and brought conviction to his heart. He imagined what it would be like to be free from the bondage of fear and sacrificing to the spirits. The next day, Calvin suggested to his parents and the whole family that they all should become Christian. They agreed, and they called a meeting to discuss the idea with their relatives. Four families decided to join them in becoming Seventh-day Adventists. Isn't that amazing? They called an Adventist pastor and a church elder and an ASAP church planter named Caleb to help them rid their home of all the idols and spirits. This made the spirits really angry. As the group entered the homes, the spirits took possession of two of the mothers. These women had formerly communicated with the spirits, and Kumsing's mother had been the spirit medium for the whole village. Now the spirits contorted the faces of the women and spoke terrible things to try to intimidate the Christians. The church leaders countered this demonic assault with prayer, and the evil spirits left the women. Even though the evil spirits had been cast out, they didn't give up. Soon, they stirred up the village against Calvin and his family. The villagers accused them of angering the spirits. They said the spirits could not bless their village as long as they were Christians living there. Calvin's father tried to tell the villagers how becoming Christian had transformed the lives of their family members. He shared all the blessings that they had experienced after deciding to follow Jesus. But the villagers refused to listen, and they demanded that the family give up their faith or leave the village. For several weeks, tensions escalated. Finally, the villagers made a plan to destroy the church members' homes on a certain day. Everyone in the village would have to participate. They even began collecting rice and other food for a party to celebrate their victory. On the appointed day, a crowd with hammers, axes, and machetes surrounded the Christians' homes. Inside, Calvin knelt down and he prayed. He surrendered everything to God and asked him for help. Suddenly, he just felt this peace and decided to go appeal to the village leaders. Some of the villagers followed him, shouting threats. Miraculously, despite the villagers' loud protests, the village leaders forbade them from destroying the Christian homes. Today, though persecution continues in other forms, the gospel is still spreading in Calvin's village. In less than 4 years, 70 people have been baptized in Calvin's village, and more are attending church on Sabbath and studying the Bible with him. All across Southeast Asia, the good news of salvation and Jesus' soon return is advancing, and the Katu and other unreached people groups are accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Would you like to tear down the enemy's strongholds and help the unreached find freedom in Christ? I invite you to join us in praying for God to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in Jesus. Acts 26:18. Please consider supporting this important work with a financial gift to put more church planters on the ground, support missionary training, fund evangelistic meetings, or provide Bibles and materials to those who are in need. Visit asapministries.org today to donate to ASAP's Evangelism Fund, or learn how you can sponsor a church planter like Calvin. because Jesus is coming soon. Now, more than ever, mission matters.
Greetings, friends. I'm Dr. Dwayne McKee, president of Adventist World Radio, and bring you greetings from Lake Kivu, one of the most beautiful spots in the world, right here in Rwanda, next to the Congo. Goma is just right next door to us, where they're having civil war still after many years. A lot of things are happening here. A lot of people are going to be baptized today. Let me just tell you what the Rwanda Union is going to do for the next 2 years. They have 1.2 million members, about the same membership that we have in America. They want to double their membership in the next 2 years. That means they'll be doing over 2,000 evangelistic meetings every year, 4,000 altogether, and are praying that God will bless and double their membership. So in 2 years, they would have 2.4 million people here in this small country of Rwanda. It's a beautiful country, gorgeous. The food is plentiful. Just a great experience. As we preach every night, we're going to have a wonderful baptism. You see the people behind us here, probably 200-250 people will be baptized today. I just met a couple of beautiful people that Cammie's going to tell you about them, their story. They're from Uganda. One was a Catholic, one was nothing, and all of a sudden they started listening to Adventist World Radio there in Uganda, and they both decided, as they listened to the evangelistic meetings by all the churches there, that they were going to give their hearts to Jesus. Be sure you look forward to see this video about this couple from Uganda sometime in the near future. Thank you so much for your love for Adventist World Radio. And let's pray together that as Rwanda steps out in faith, that God will bless them as only He can. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the people in Rwanda. Thank you for their faith, that by praying together, by working together, that indeed their membership can be doubled. I thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
Welcome to India. If you go to the southern state of Tamil Nadu, we find the city of Thanjavur. For the past 70 years, the E.D. Thomas Memorial Higher Secondary School has been teaching, training, and introducing students and teachers to Christ. Most of our church leaders in this region receive training from this school. The 2,350 students come from a variety of family backgrounds and religions, all longing to get a good education.
Most of the children, they're coming from very, very poor background. But it is our duty to give the moral support to the children, building the character building. That is our motto. No one to live in this school without education, without God's spiritual power. That is our duty.
Surrounded by other schools, this school offers unique values that attract parents.
There are so many schools around here, but parents bring here. Nearby also parents bring here, just because we are teaching discipline and about God.
Due to its age, this school faces serious problems with its facilities.
The girls, hostel, it is not secure because the building is very old. The government very strictly ordered do not have the asbestos-seated roof because it is affect the children. The government very strictly ordered to demolish the oldest building and especially in the asbestos seat.
Miralini is one of the students staying in the girls' dorm. Coming to this school was a challenging experience because she needed to travel far from home. Even though she didn't come from an Adventist background, she made good friends in the dorm, learned about God, and excelled in class. She still admits there is room for improvement.
Yeah, we need some improvement because the hostel is not with concrete walls. In summer days, we're feeling so hard. We have to change this. And the toilet is not enough for us. We need some more rooms and some facilities there.
This quarter, a portion of your 13th Sabbath offering will help renovate the girls' dorm at E.D. Thomas Memorial Higher Secondary School, providing the students with a safer place to stay. Please pray for the students and teachers at this school. Pray that this school can effectively represent Christ despite their current situation.
Thank you for supporting 13th Sabbath offering for e-school.
Good morning. Sabbath blessings to everyone. The weather is supposed to be into the teens in the next couple days. Yep, big thumbs up. 20, plus 20. Plus 20, really. That'll take care of all the snow, the remainder of the snow. Happy Sabbath. Feliz Sabado. Yes. That's right. Bol Sabah? Bol Sabah, yeah. And then, happy? No, happy. Happy Sabbath, sunset. That's a happy sunset Sabbath, sunset day, yeah. Yeah, and we have a Ukrainian pastor. And I've talked to the pastor two or three times this week now, too. So he's preaching this week in Spruce Grove. But he has an interpreter with him every time he preaches. So, yeah, what that's going to look like, we'll have to see when he arrives. He's nervous about stepping into a three-church district and not having that wall of communication in front of him. So I just told him, I says, we are going to do our very best to learn Ukrainian. And I said, give him a wink of the eye, you know, with a little emoji with a wink of the eye there. Because we're communicating through email, and that's probably one of the more comfortable ways that he can communicate right now until he just arrives and kind of hangs out with us. So we'll see what happens. Pray for him. You know, we've been praying for him and about him. I don't know either. Now, so next week, as I mentioned, excuse me, I've got to get rid of this cough here. Now, I'm not sick. My wife is not feeling well, but I'm just, it's a seasonal type of that lung thing that I've got going on. What were we just going to say? I just lost my... Yeah, so next Sabbath, April 6th, he will be in Smoky Lake for his, call it a installation Sabbath. So he's now the first Sabbath where he'll be speaking. I don't know what he's going to do. He's got a translator with him. A lot more Ukrainians out in the Smoky Lake area, so maybe they'll do better. Pardon me? Well, yeah, you know, maybe the elderlies and that, so I don't know. But that, so next week is his first introduction into the district. Thereafter, I've invited him to just come to church service and hang out and just spend the next few weeks, few months, just get acquainted and watch us preach and lead out in the church service, and he'll just get an idea of what we're all about. I've sent him a whole bunch of media links of our promo video and that too, and he's just totally amazed. Just, okay, we got a happening church here in Fort Saskatchewan. So, but they got a happening church in Smoky Lake too, and Boyle's been established for years too, so it's all good. Quarterly's on the table for church members. They're not available just for guests. Now, I don't want to sound chintzy. Is that a unsanctified word? We need to make sure that all the church members get them first. Make sure you put your names on them, just so if you do leave it somewhere that we're able to. What's another word for chintzy? Cheap? Anyways, you know what I'm trying to say. Church members get them first. Yeah. Frugal. Thank you. Frugal. There's the word. Thank you. Okay, seminars, are you enjoying the seminar presentations online? I'm having fun doing them too, and it's always a refresher in my brain and my heart too, so for those who can come out. Now, we're finished our three nights per week roll of the last 3 weeks. We've done 10 presentations, so the next 5 weeks will be not Tuesday night. I had mentioned to you before that they're going to be on Tuesday night, but we're moving that to Monday. Monday just seems to work better. So on Monday night, we'll be back again for the Bride of Christ. And then each week, maybe I'll do one on the Sabbath here. We'll see what happens here. But today is communion service, so that is important for us. Fundraising for our camera equipment. The Pentecostal Church, I talked to them about getting permission to be able to hardwire a couple permanent cameras in the sanctuary. So we're thinking of purchasing a couple. They're not going to be cheap, these cameras, but they are a panning camera. They're called a PTZ, a point, tilt, zoom camera. One in the back, one on the side, and then we've got other cameras going on with phones. But just pray for that, because our streaming is actually, I'm getting text messages from people from all around California who are watching them too. Even though we only got a few, it's just that it's available online. So people, yeah, we're getting the tentacles of our church service awareness out. And so if you want to give sacrificially for camera equipment, just put AV, audio visual. You can highlight on their camera equipment and we'll make sure that it goes to that also. And I think that's about it. Let's take a moment and give a holy hug to those next to you, around you, and we'll get ready for church service. A holy hug or a handshake? Holy hug or a sacred handshake? Our Father in heaven, even though we live and move and have our being in you 7 days a week, it is a sacred privilege to step into your presence on your holy Sabbath,
the day that you have sanctified and blessed. And as we now remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, and we spend time in sacred and sweet fellowship together, may you be glorified in all that is proceeded with this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Would the congregation please rise? I'll get you to turn my microphone down just a bit here. Thank you.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. And all God's people said heartily,
amen.
Amen to the Lord. You may be seated. We want to ask for our little lambs to come forward. And older lambs might have to just vacate for just a second.
How to big you two are getting. Mm-hmm. Crazy. Well, good morning, girls, and good morning to the rest of our congregation this morning. Happy Sabbath. Happy Easter. Mm-hmm. What do you girls think about when you think of Easter? What comes to mind? Be honest.
Chocolate.
I'm not getting any answers from the girls. Go ahead. What do you think about when you think of bunnies? Yeah. And spring? That's right. Yeah. Yes. Spring and flowers. That's a good answer. Yeah. Anything else? What should we be celebrating for Easter? Yes. That's right. When Jesus died for our sins and He was raised up. That's right. So I'm going to read you an Easter story today. And that's what it's about. Okay? It's called The Story of Easter. When spring comes, baby animals are born and flowers begin to bloom, just like you said. Oh, I liked it better over there. Sorry. So there's your baby bunnies, right? That you were talking about. And your baby chicks. Springtime also brings Easter. On Easter, we remember Jesus and what He did for us. Jesus loved all boys and girls and moms and dads too. He was called the Good Shepherd. Do you know why we call Him the Good Shepherd? What do we call on the man that takes care of the sheep? A shepherd, and what does he do with his flock? That's right, he watches over his sheep, and Jesus watches over us. Moms and dads and boys and girls love Jesus, too. They laid palm branches in his path. But some men did not like Jesus. They put him on a cross to die. His friends were sad. On that first Easter, Jesus' friends met an angel. The angel told them, "Jesus has risen. He is alive today." Jesus' friends were very happy. We celebrate Easter because Jesus lived again on the first Easter morning. On Sabbath, we go to church and sing about Jesus. Our church places crosses on their steeple to remind us of Jesus' love. Now on Easter morning, you'll know that Jesus loved us so much that he gave his life for us so that we can live too. Amen, right? So we're very grateful to Jesus on this Easter weekend. Amen. And that's my story. Amen. Would anyone like to pray this morning? Okay.
Heavenly Father, thank you that you died on the cross for us, and please you help us to be like you, to forgive and to love each other. Please you help us to be kind. And thank you that there's many people here. Thank you that some people know you in this earth. And please you help the people that don't know you in this earth to know you. Amen. And to give their lives to you. Please you help the homeless to get food, water, and money, because some people out there aren't that wealthy like we are, and sometimes they have a rock for a pillow. Please you help us and them to see the good in the earth and not the bad. In the name of Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
From the mouth of babes, right? Mm. Thank you for doing that. Okay, meet me at the back and I have something
Jesus
for you.
Jesus died for all the children.
Is scheduled to sing. Oh, she wasn't?
Yeah.
Okay, so then it's us. Okay, sounds good.
They texted and asked.
Did they? Okay. Go ahead.
Sure, okay. Okay, we're going to fill in the blanks on our scripture passage. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the
care
Is it Mighty Hand? Oh, it is Mighty Hand, okay, of God. That he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he...
Oh, no.
Oh, there you go.
No, you missed it. What is it?
Somewhere quick. 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7. Let's repeat it together, shall we all? Okay. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7.
Would you stand with us, please?
Salvation to talks with me, alone lies there away. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. What are you thankful for today? Life, breath,
the sun,
waking
health.
Up, yep, Sabbath day,
amen.
I'm glad somebody put that one into the
amen.
Mix. Go ahead. Connection? Yeah, absolutely. Church family is a friend, is a support group. Denise? Amen, amen. I tell you, I mean, the Sabbath experience is what I live for and plan for each day of the week, and it's been like that for 38 years, and it's just coming to church. It's just like this is the crowning act of our week experience of sweet fellowship, some good food, and then go home and sleep and get ready for another one.
Oh, yeah.
That too.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Freedoms.
He's coming again.
Freedoms we temporarily have.
Eugene, I think we need that microphone up here. Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Shall I see Jesus and reign with him above, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning? Clothed on the darling garment and everlasting love, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning? Oh, I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Word on the gospel armor of faith and hope and love, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. And when the combat shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning.
us. Our offering today is for local church budget. If we could have a couple of our young deaconesses in training to come forward.
Do Olivia or Sophia want to do that? Oh, yes, okay, we've got some coming here.
Got the bags there? Say a prayer, please, Joel, for our offering.
Let's bow our heads. Dear Father, Lord in heaven, Lord, thank you so much for this day, Lord. Thank you for bringing us here to this place together to worship together and praise your mighty name. Lord, we thank you for your death on the cross. More so, we thank you for your resurrection, Lord, that promises us a resurrection as well. We ask that you come quickly. Lord, that you empower us to do this work so we can go home. We pray now that this the money that we're putting forth here will go towards your cause. Lord, we know that you are not in need of it. You can do all things, but we give in faith, knowing that we are co-laborers with you in this work. We pray that it will go to where it needs to go. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You two come a little bit closer here. Okay.
Will you this moment, this grace receive?
good now. Grace,
grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
You can shake your finger at me later on that one.
That's fine. No problem.
Write down our prayer requests.
Got everything that you need?
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. So if you have a praise that you want to bring up to God or a request for yourself or for others, we have so many others we need to be praying for. Others first, right? Above all. Karina, did I see your hand up for... Yes. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yes. So we pray for them and protection over our children, keep their hearts pure. Yes, Sherry.
Good morning. Yes, my brother in Regina, Saskatchewan, has been in the hospital for the last week. He's 4 years older than me. So I've been praying all week for him, and I just ask God, please heal him. And I pray for the spirit to be going in him. And God knows everything, so I want him to get better and get healthy. And he was supposed to come out and stay with me for a month, so... I pray that if he does come, he'll come to church with me, and he goes to the United Church, but I want him to come to our church too, so I'm praying for him, and I'm praying for all of our children and everyone that's suffering with cancer and diseases, and there's so much going on out there. Yeah. Please be with everybody, God, for we all need you, and we're thankful for the Sabbath day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lena.
We'd like prayer for Serena. Serena's birthday was this past week, and not celebrating birthdays anymore at 38 years old. So I don't know where this puts him, but God needs to look after him, and he needs to make a choice for God.
Dawn?
I want to say a prayer for Bud. He's not with us today. He's not feeling good. He was feeling quite badly yesterday or last night more so. And he's like, oh, I don't want to miss church tomorrow. So he wanted to be here. And I was like, well, we'll just see how things go. We'll pray. But he couldn't make it. So we pray for him.
And there are a few others that are not well today, so as well,
yeah, so
anyone that's not here with us.
Mm-hmm.
Stuart?
Lisa and Greg. I have a special Thanksgiving prayer this week. I had some cattle that were supposed to be arriving this week, and everything looked good Sunday and Monday. Everything looked good. In fact, I had some extra helpers come out on Monday, and we're tearing apart fencing that was old and decrepit where the cows would get out and all this stuff, and everything looked good. Come Tuesday morning, the back tire of the tractor is gone. Go to put air in it to find out that it's got calcium water in it. So it has to be filled with water and air, and the tube's leaking. And I still have feed to get for the animals. We still have to put up the metal panels. And then a cousin of mine, we did an overnight to go and get some wooden panels just to fix things up for right now. Right now we had to go get a trailer
and then come back to his farm, and got back at 5 o'clock in the morning, and the cows are coming at just after 1, and I still had to get to the bank to get the check to pay the delivery and everything. And you know, Lord worked it all out. The fences went up, everything went secure.
Praise God.
The calves are the most gentle calves I've had in a long time. Right now there's 9 of them out there, and they'll follow you. If you put your hand out, they'll come right up to the fence. And they're curious animals right now. And and then with the tractor, my brother got that going. And then yesterday I went to put some bedding down because I knew last night was going to get colder. And the front tire went on it. And then it became a Sabbath issue. Like, we still need some feed. We need some other things. And just by God's grace, my brother was able to come out, patch the tubes. I was able to go deliver eggs. We were able to make the seminar last night and then be at church here today.
Wow, and even be at the seminar last night.
Made the seminar last Marvelous. Night. You know, God is amazing. So
Praise
I just
God.
Want to thank him for, even though in the moment it seemed very, very frustrating, God was in control. He says, just trust me and I'll look after it.
Any others? Randy?
Would like to pray for a friend of mine. I'm not going to mention his name, but he's going through a messy divorce, and it's been ongoing, and it's a lot of pain and suffering. So just hope that God intervenes and where it needs to go. Mm-hmm. So it's a prayer for my friend. Just say
sure.
Randy's friend. Thanks.
Okay. Vince, did you have a request as well or a praise?
Thank you for the opportunity. I'd appreciate another prayer for Wendy's son, who's battling with addiction, and he's kind of clinging to life at the moment. Mm-hmm. I hate to say that, but that's the reality of it. So I personally hope that this person, who I haven't met, makes it through. So anyways, without getting emotional over that, I would appreciate that. And also a prayer for the children, as mentioned, young people, because it's a difficult situation for them to grow up in this world from what they're seeing, and they're always influenced to fit in, and we know that a lot of that fitting in means doing things that are
contrary to
a life well lived, but that's hard for them to see. So with that, I'll just say thank you, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you today.
Thank absolutely you. And we're so glad you are with us here. Randy? Oh, okay. Randy, I see you. Christine had her hand up, and then I'll give you a chance, Randy, okay?
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I would like to have prayer for a couple that have been sending all the literature and sending them seminars when they're on. They live in Grand Prairie, and so I'd like to pray for the conviction by the Holy Spirit to convict them of the truth. And also my son Jason, his stump is healed and he's waiting to go into the Glen Rose, and he needs a stick leg they're going to give him, but the government won't give him a stick leg and a wheelchair. He has to pay for one or the other.
Oh, I see.
And he's on AISH. I don't understand how the government can, you know, see a person who's on AISH, who gets very, very little money every month, and how he's supposed to, you know, buy a wheelchair for himself. Like, wheelchairs are anywhere from, I mean, $3,000 and up, right?
Wow.
So I just need prayer for him.
Sure.
And also I know that Eugene has been sending the seminar out to a lot of people. And we just ask that the Holy Spirit touch their hearts and they come to know the truth.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Beautiful truth it is. So beautiful. Randy.
Mm.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Okay. Pardon? Herman? Okay. Eugene, did I see your hand up?
Well, the Lord has truly blessed me since I've been in this church, and I thank all of the members who have prayed that my brain would be healed and I would start remembering and being able to plan and do the Lord's work a little bit better, and things are going really good. I want to thank the Lord for our brother Vince here from Vince's Computer Repairs, and he's built me a brand new, well, it's not brand new, it's reused, refurbished, but built me a beautiful computer which I will be able to do more of the Lord's work with. Thank you, Vince. I would like to have you guys pray for my friend Randy, who I took care of for 2.5 years. When I first got him at my house, he was paralyzed on his left side, arm and leg, and couldn't speak properly and couldn't function, couldn't feed himself and that sort of thing. So he's recovered and healed within that 2.5 years. But unfortunately, when I left Edmonton 7 months ago, he's deteriorated since then. And I just recently went and spoken to him and helped him out again and whatnot. So I would like you guys to pray that he heals emotionally and psychologically and mentally, and the Lord blesses him and his future with the Lord. So thank you.
Okay. Is that everyone?
Let's pray for those struggling with personal conviction.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we have another.
I've been having a little bit of a flare-up with my MS, so if I just have prayer for that.
Okay.
Subdued now.
Oh, how the world to evil that lures me. Oh, how my heart is.
you're able, would you kneel with us, please? Our loving Heavenly Father, O Lord, we offer our praise and our thanks to you, Lord, for your goodness. You are good and just and holy. Lord, all your doings are good and just. And when we see so much hurt and evil in this world, some question your goodness. But Lord, we've seen proven over and over throughout your word and in our own lives your goodness. And we understand your plan for us as we study your word, Lord. We know there's so much better coming when, Lord, when you take us out of this world and you recreate this world new. Lord, we know that until such time you give us strength, you give us wisdom, you help us, you see us through. Lord, you didn't just stay afar off, looking down upon us in this world with all of its trials. But Lord, you came down personally in human form. And you took the brunt of the worst of it. The worst evils, all of the evils, every bit of it. And for all our sin. And we're so thankful for giving yourself on the cross, for your sacrifice for us, Lord. And we thank you that that's not where it ended. We thank you that you rose again. And that gives us such great hope, because we now can hope also in the resurrection. So Lord, whatever we're going through, whatever our loved ones are going through, we all can have that marvelous hope in knowing for a fact, it's not empty hope, it's for a fact, that all things will be restored and made right. Justice will be served. And eternity will be glorious and joyful and peaceful and, Lord, everything as it should be through all eternity. And we will be with you face to face. We thank you that this is your good plan. Lord God Almighty, this list, you've heard each one, each name. So each of these people, Lord, that require healing, may they understand these beautiful truths. We do ask for healing right now, Lord. We do ask for healing for them. We ask that they take responsibility also for the things that you've given us a beautiful health message to help us to restore and to maintain good health. So we do help ask for your help in being faithful in those things. We do ask for healing, Lord, as your people cooperate with you. And Lord, for those who don't know you, that they, through this, that this will bring them to you. To learn that they can rely upon you, and yet you are the great physician and the great healer. And Lord, may we all learn to trust you and rely upon you moment by moment. Even if we have to wait until Jesus comes for our healings. Lord, there are relationships that are broken down. We ask for restoration in those things. There are people who need help with their work. There are silent prayers among us. You've heard all of this list, Lord. And we give our children into your hands, Father. Protect them, lead them. Help us to be examples and lead them. And we give our gratitude once again, Lord, for all the answered prayers, for your love, and for everything you have in store. And knowing that we can trust you fully. Heavenly Father, We ask all these things and lift up our praise also in the name of Jesus Christ.
Happy Sabbath, Church. This morning's scripture reading is taken from 1 John chapter 3, verse 16 to 19. And it says here that, stand up as far as possible. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso has this world's good, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. May the Lord add his blessings to this reading. Amen.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, as we now engage our hearts and minds in the sacred ordinance of communion and reflection on the things thereof and in, we ask for your presence to permeate this building, and that our hearts will be encouraged and edified and inspired as we leave from this building. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
True or false?
True. We were saved. We are. We are being saved. We will be saved. It's past, present, and future to serve because of Jesus. And that's what communion service is all about. Turn with me, if you will. Just not yet. What we need to do here is I'm going to just read something for you. And I thought I was going to be preaching my sermon right now, but we're not. We're going to do the ordinance of humility. Now, I'm reading here from John 13. And you will remember, if you've read this passage before, Jesus is now in the upper room with his disciples. And he just finishes washing their feet. And he explains in chapter 13, verses 15. We'll read verse 13. He says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you say well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought also to wash one another's feet." Verse 15 on the screen. "For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you." That's a perpetual example for God's church for the last two millennia, and an invitation for us to come close to Jesus and to recognize what it means to be a Christian, that because we were saved to serve. We are going to separate for a few minutes for our sacred ordinance of humility, where the church gathers together to make an expression, demonstrate an expression of love for one another. The ladies will go down out this door, down the stairs. The men will proceed through this door. We have a curtain downstairs separating the men from the women. Some churches, they do provide a room for couples, married couples, to wash each other's feet, but we just don't have the room for that. So it's women with women, men with men. And if you would just bow your heads, we're going to offer up a word of prayer. There'll be music playing upstairs, reflective music, as we come up, and we'll get ready for the next phase of our communion service. Father in heaven, it is only because of the grand and exalted truth of you living in our hearts that we can even fathom or appreciate this ordinance. For those here, Lord, that might be new to the experience or feeling a little bit awkward, we pray that you will help us to see past our own feelings to what it means to be blessed by you and to be givers rather than takers. And bless us now as we dismiss. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So for a few minutes, women out this door, ladies this door, and men this door, and then we'll meet back here in just a few minutes. you'll turn with me in your Bibles. I have a short message here in Philippians 2, verses 3 to 8. Philippians 2. And last night when I went to bed, usually when I'm preaching a sermon on a specific message, I like to just listen to those pertinent chapters on my audio while I'm sleeping, and just amazing insights in the book of Philippians. It's something you just got to stop and breathe in every single passage. And it's amazing because all it was a letter, if you will, from a very godly individual to the church at Philippi, yet the man, being led by the Holy Spirit, said some profound and beautiful things. So Philippians 2, we'll read verses 3 to 5. Notice what it says here. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. What do you think? What's a synonym for that? Let nothing be done through strife? Selfish ambition. Okay, I mean, you've got different translations, right? I'm reading for the King James, so the New King James would say selfish ambition? Selfishness. Okay. Vainglory. Yeah, I mean, when you have a vanity, right, and you stand in front of a vanity, you're looking at self. So vainglory would be self-exaltation, self-focus. And he says, let nothing be done through this attitude or this mindset of strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. You got to stop and take that in. So it means through the journey of life, through the interactions at work, at home, etc., esteeming another person's interests over and above your own interests. We need to take care of ourselves, right? But we still need to make sure that we live to give, not to take. We live to help, not to hurt. You heard that term, disinterested benevolence? You heard that term before? Disinterested benevolence. Basically, you're more concerned about the well-being of others rather than your own well-being. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. No man, no woman is an island to themselves. We live for the purpose of influencing others, and we will be held accountable for our actions towards others. And get verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's God's high ideal for us, friends, is to possess the mind of Christ. I mean, granted, and I think you can understand this, if we can see the world through the eyes of Jesus, that's the ultimate experience of learning to be able to view the world around us with the mind of Christ, to see others as Christ sees others. And when Christ lives in us, the world is a better place to live, a kinder place to live, peaceful, that's right, a more honest place to live. You know, I bought a phone for our church, my church cameras this weekend. The gentleman advertised it as like new, a like new phone. And I had a couple pictures of it. So I drove 80 kilometers from Fort Saskatchewan into central Edmonton to meet him in a mall to sit down and take a look at the phone. When he handed me the phone, it looked somewhat what it looked like in the picture. And then it had a case on it. And I pulled the case. He goes, oh, it's got a little crack in the back. And I opened the back, and it was shattered. The whole thing was just like a useless, shattered phone. And I looked at him. I says, are you kidding me? I says, he said, like new. He says, I didn't say brand new. I said, like new. And I just got up, and I walked away. And I just thought, do you think that might fall into the category of not esteeming other better than yourself? Also this week, an interesting week, I was walking through Walmart, and there was a wallet on the floor, a fat wallet. I mean, the first thought that came to my mind was, oh no, the person who lost that wallet is going to be stressed out. And people are walking up and down the aisle, so it's in good hands with Pastor Darrell,
right? Pre-conversion, I can tell you that 40 years ago, 38 years ago, if I would have found the wallet, the first thing thought would have come to my mind is, what's in it for me? But post-conversion, it's, oh no, somebody's stressed. And so I scanned through the, I looked at it through the ID and saw the lady's picture and thought, you know, she looks familiar, like somebody that just passed me by a few minutes ago. And I walked up and down the aisles and I kind of singled her out with the ID, said, that's got to be her. And I walked up and I said, ma'am, did you lose anything? Yeah, my wallet. I just found it on the ground. And her husband just like, ah, oh, thank you. You know, just it's nice to know that there's some people in the world who could have the proclivity to give it back. But God wants us to esteem others better than ourselves. Yes.
Oh.
Then I went and got groceries. Went to pay for the groceries. No purse. No purse.
Yeah.
So I went back to the dressing room and it was still there. Thank you, Lord.
I wish I could say that. I lost my wallet a couple of years ago walking into a store and I retraced all my steps and it was gone, never to be seen again with my cash and all my ID. And it was stressful, totally stressful. I was just praying that somebody would find it who has the mind of Christ. And it wasn't to be, because Jesus says, and this is where our prayers are important, because God does walk with us through the circumstances of life, and we want to, and pray that God will guard our movements, and if we do have a mishap, that we'll be intersecting with like-minded individuals. But let me show you something. You remember that show? You remember Sesame Street, and there was this little segment, and it would say, you know, one of these things doesn't belong with the other. Can you tell which one it is? Da, 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 da. And you got to take a look at some objects. Well, we're going to play that right now, okay? I'm going to show you four pictures, and one of those pictures of the four doesn't belong with the other. You tell me what number of picture it is. Number one? You're sure? Okay. All right. Let me show you another one here. Number two. You're sure? Another one. Number two. Two. That's right, yeah, that's right. You're thinking that they're painting graffiti. They're actually taking it off. That's right. How about that one? Number four. Now, let me ask you a question here. Out of these groups of pictures, what is it? What's the characteristic about the ones that don't belong with the pictures? Self? Yeah, living for self. Yeah, they're not. Yeah, that's well. That would beg the question: what do the ones that all group together have in common? The picture. Yeah, giving. Yes, putting others first rather than their own interests. You know, I used to have Oilers season tickets. I would eat, sleep, and breathe sports, and I had my football, CFL. Season tickets, and you know, once I became a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, and I would be at every game, and boy, those tickets were very expensive at the time. That was back in the day when Oilers had their five Stanley Cups almost in a row, and then a few months later into my conversion, I went to a hockey game and sat in the environment. And now, I don't want to step on any toes if you're a hockey buff, but I was just surprised to hear all the vulgar, foul language that didn't kind of hit me pre-conversion. And now, post-conversion, I'm listening to all the garbage and filth going on and the fighting. And you've heard that old statement, I went to a fight last night and a hockey game broke out, you know, because that's what they see. But, you know, we have to ask ourselves, if you've got the mind of Christ, there's going to be certain things in and of our world that become distasteful, right? You know, we're told to love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him or her. For all that is of the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the desires of the flesh, the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is going to pass away, and all those desires therein. But he that does the will of my Father in heaven abideth forever. That's 1 John, same book that we read in our scripture reading, 1 John 2, verses 15 to 17. My son, he sings these songs. He got into this kick with some contemporary Christian music. And I'm more conservative in my music styles, and I find some of it a little bit too rocky, but there's some really powerful lyrics in some of these songs and very melodious. But there's a song by this fellow Matthew West, if you've ever listened to his music, and the song's called Do Something. And, you know, the question that we're asking ourselves, have you ever wondered, you know, when and how God is going to end all the sorrow and suffering in our world? Have you ever asked that question? Lord, why don't you put an end to this all? It's so unfair. There's so much injustice. And the lyrics of the song go like this. I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now. Thought, how'd we ever get so far down? How's it ever going to turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven, and I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me. So I shook my fist at heaven, and I said, God, why don't you do something? And he said, I did. I created you. And it spoke to me because, you know, God's solution. What is God's solution for a sin-sick, troubled world? Well, not you. It's Christ in you. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, which begs reading the next part of that. Take a look at verse 6. It explains now the demonstration of the mind of Christ. Verse 6, Philippians 2, verse 6. Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Now, that's a bit of a word twister, a brain twister. It says, you know, basically that God, Jesus, did not consider equality with God something to retain. He was willing to step down from this exalted nature of eternal. He's still eternal, but he now retains, excuse me, he now retains the form of a human being for how long? Eternity. Now, I don't fully understand it because obviously in eternity, then Jesus, one with the Father, was co-eternal, but it was divine, and now he's left that divinity of the substance that he was, and he's become a human being forever, for eternity. And in eternity, he will ever bear the scars, the marks, the reminders of what he did to go for the highest, from the highest to the lowest, if you will, to become a human being. And it says, but made himself of no reputation, or whatever reputation he had in heaven, if you will, and probably speaking about a humble servant on earth as a human, and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men, that word anthropos, mankind, and being found in fashion or likeness as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You got to take that in. Have you ever wondered, you know, what Jesus meant when he says, take up your cross and follow me? Ever wondered that? What does that mean? It's found right in the verse in Matthew 16, verses 24. It says, if any man, thank you for that. And let me just kind of have a sip of that right now. Thank you, Joel, for thinking of me, esteeming myself better than yourself, if you will. If any man will come after me, let him do what? Deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Denying yourself for the upbuilding and blessing of others. to follow Jesus, I mean, Jesus went about doing good, right? That was the description in a snapshot of the life of Jesus. And Jesus says, take up your cross by denying yourself. That's in lowliness of mind, esteeming others better than ourselves. And I know this all looks good on paper, because one of the hardest things to develop in our Christian experience is learning to treat others better than ourselves. But that's the work of the Holy Spirit, to help us apply the principles of God's word and then move through each phase and circumstance of life, learning that it's all about living to give rather than living to take. And, you know, one indiscretion in our lives of taking can actually damage our characters if we get into the hardened habit of living to take rather than to give. You know, the World Trade Centers, you know how long it took to build them up? To build them? 10 years. You know how long it took to bring them down? A couple of hours or so, because of the enemy within. So it takes longer to build up in the work of a lifetime to build character, but it's Christ in us, a consistent staying close to Jesus. And yeah, when they finally came down, that's right. Yeah, that's right. Didn't take long here. You know, there is this, if you've been to Israel here, there's two bodies of water in Israel. And one of them is called the Dead Sea, the other one the Sea of Galilee. One of them is teeming with life. The other one is dead and lifeless. You know why it's called the Dead Sea? Nothing lives. You know why nothing lives? Well, it's salt. That's right. The sodium. That's right. There's nothing coming out from it. All the water flows in, and it stays there. And it just solidifies. And not solidifies. That's another way. Well, saline, you know, and it builds saline. Have you ever been in you swam in the Dead Sea? I should show you a picture of it, but you float like a cork in it. I've got a magazine, and I'm just sitting there in my bathing suit, and you're just floating on the top of the water because it's so high in sodium, nothing sinks. But the Sea of Galilee, you have the waters from the mountains of Syria, Mount Hermon, and they flow into the Sea of Galilee, and then they flow out into three tributaries into the land of Israel. You know, water is a real commodity, a rare commodity in Israel. We don't know what that's like in Canada. There's like 31,000 lakes. 31,752 lakes in Canada. So we have lots of fresh water, but there they have one body of water and it feeds the entire nation. But the thing is, if we surrender, and that's the key, a surrender, and that's why communion service is so important, because it's teaching us a dependence on the one who came to give, and he humbled himself as a servant. And here's a statement that might be of an eye-opener to you. Catch grasp the significance of this. The completeness of Christian character is attained when the impulse to help and bless others springs constantly from within. So if you want to arrive at that pinnacle, and you'll never know it anyways, right? Because we always see our shortcomings, and that's part of humility, right? But the completeness of Christian character, the highest ideal of perfection, Christian perfection, is seen when is attained when the impulse to help and to bless others springs constantly, habitually, from within. So you wake up in the morning and you go through your routine in your home. Christianity begins in the home, right? Why is that? Well, you know, the people we love the most are sometimes the people we mistreat the most. Sometimes, and we have to learn how to get along, and then from there we move into the community, into our work environment, etc. But who are the others that's mentioned in here? Help and bless others? Well, they include not just the lovable, but the unlovable. It's easy to love the lovable, isn't it? In fact, somebody had made this statement before. I thought it's worthy of recitation. Let's say it together. You love Jesus Christ only as much as the person you love the least. Just think that. Take that in. Do you love Jesus? Yes. Only as much as the person you love the least. I see some conviction on people's faces here. You got to think this through. Just say, okay, yeah. I need to remember that. If you've done it unto the least of these, my brethren, Jesus says, you've done it unto me. And we were saved to serve. And somebody had said, a wise guy during Sabbath school, people do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. And that's right. I mean, we've got a package of truths, and it's so wonderful to give this package to people and help them to see the amazing facts of Bible prophecy, but it means nothing unless they know that we care, right? It needs to come across as Christ-centered. And our world, friends, is dying because people just do not care. And fortunately, Jesus says, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. And our world is breaking down before our eyes. I've seen now in the last 3 or 4 years, I'm a gasp at the coldness. I read this article the other day, a newspaper article. I should have actually put it on the screen. A young 9-year-old boy they found in front of his school, and he was dead. He was under a tree and just sitting there, but he was lifeless. And they could not determine the cause of death. And when family services was called in and they did some investigation, discovered that the young boy had a very abusive home, a loveless, abusive home, and he had no friends at school. And unfortunately, he probably just became hopeless. And he just sat under a tree and he expired. I thought, that should not happen. I mean, to give means to give life to people, to give them hope, right? Does the impulse to help and bless others spring constantly from within you? That's a self-inspecting question. For most of us, it does not come naturally. And it can, though, if we, Jesus knocks at the door, right? He says, if any man will open the door, I will come in and sup with him, and he with me. And if we spend time in that personal communion with Jesus, giving him the permission. Have you prayed that prayer recently? Lord, do whatever it takes to prepare me for eternity. Anybody want to admit that they prayed that prayer before? That's an unnerving prayer to pray. Lord, just try not to make it hurt so much, right? But do whatever you need to do. It's kind of like, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. So we need to pray, open up our heart to God. We need to spend time in God's word, understanding the dynamics of what it means to love unconditionally. And we need to look for opportunities to share Christ with others. Amen? And our life on earth is a preparation field for an eternity with Jesus and with each other. And what will heaven really be like? It's a place of disinterested benevolence where we are living to give, right? I listened to this dream. I want to tell the story again because I know I've said it before years ago, but I love telling it. This man had a dream, and he saw in his dream two doors. One said heaven, the other one said hell. Well, you know, he knew which door he's going to go through. He's invited to walk through the one that says heaven. But he's curious. What does it look like in hell? So he opens up the door, and he peeks in, and he's beholds a table, a banquet table, as far as the eye could see, with billions of people sitting at the table, and all the food, a sumptuous banquet, fare of food along this table. And it looks so delicious and so eloquent, elegant, and yet everybody looks so frustrated and angry, emaciated and gaunt. And he looked a little closer, and he noticed that everyone, instead of having a hand at the end of their arm, they had this 4-foot extension of a spoon handle and a spoon at the end. And he could see that everybody was trying to pick up some food from this banquet, and they were trying to bite on it, but they couldn't reach it with their mouth and the spoon. And everybody was so frustrated. He thought, that's strange. And he shut the door, and he decided to look in the door that says heaven. And he saw the same thing, a table as far as the eye could see with millions of people seated And everybody looks so ruddy and fresh-skinned and happy and vital, full of vitality, and just a totally different picture and countenances on their expressions. And he looked, he saw all the food there on the table, and everybody, he noticed that they still had these, you know, no hand, as an extension on their arm, but these four-foot extensions with a spoon. And he watched, and he said, I saw everybody, and they were feeding each other. They were picking up food, and they were feeding everybody around them. And they were living to give, right? That's what heaven's going to be like. When we're in heaven, we're living to give, to live for each other, friends. And that's what communion is about, the invitation by God for us to learn how to be servants, to bless others. And it can only be done through the work of the Holy Spirit. Again, I want to emphasize, Jesus says, be ye therefore perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Just before that, I actually wrote it down. He says, in this is Matthew 5, verse 48, be ye therefore perfect even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And then the verse before that, he says, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Again, it's easy to love those who are kind and lovable around you, but those who are unkind, that's a different thing altogether. That's where we need supernatural help, and that's only through the power of God's Spirit in our lives. So let's partake. And get the deacons to come forward and just pull this table. Come on up. Pull the table forward about 2 feet. That's good. Just back a little bit more. That's good. Thank you. You can sit down. I'm just going to kneel and offer up a word of prayer of consecration for the bread. We will distribute it, have a few comments along the way. I'll ask a couple questions and invoke any comments, and then we'll do the same over the wine. If you'll just bow your heads with me, please. Father in heaven, we don't fully, I'm sure, grasp the significance
of what we're about to partake of, but it's sacred. As often as we do these things, we do show your death until you come, and that we can do no other than invite you to have complete control of our lives and to live in us. Lord, may this bread be a worthy emblem as it is consecrated for this moment of dedicated to you as a emblem of your broken body and what it might mean to all of us in a personal way. We ask for your blessing and your anointing over these items. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Has there been an experience of recently where you've had an opportunity to express the giving love of Christ to someone in some way? As you think over the past few weeks, yes, we've got a hand up here. Thanks, Joel.
Young gentleman by the name of Michael. I coached hockey this year on Wednesdays, and he helped me out with some power skating, and my nephew came over. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting because even though it was just farm work, taking staples out of a post and different things, we started the day with a prayer and ended kind of talking about God. And when Michael's mom came and picked him up, she said, I'll be in touch. And then she contacted me a little while later and said, you know what? We'd like Michael to spend more time. We're a non-denominational Christian family. Mm-hmm. And he came home just, and she goes, my son is kind of, he's kind of a jock, right? Like he likes hockey, that kind of stuff. And he comes home and he just enjoyed the day and wants to know more. So.
Awesome. Yes, Don? Don? Yes.
Oh, sorry.
We're there to help you.
Okay. This is a very little, but when I go to work, I keep some money in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
And so if sometimes somebody comes, if they're short, I can help. And I got the privilege of doing that. And she was very grateful. It's an older lady, and I just was blessings to her. And yeah, that was all.
Amen. Thank you for that. Anyone else have had an experience recently where you've been able to help somebody in some way, whether it's a word of encouragement or, yes, Randy? A rental home and veteran, okay.
We got a family that's living there right now.
Yeah.
And their 6.5-month-year-old daughter has been in the hospital, in and out. She's got, it's kind of a autoimmune disease.
Okay.
And it's affecting possibly her heart and mm-hmm. kidneys, and there's other things that are going on. And anyways, just to help them out, we help them out with some money
mm-hmm.
so that they can commute back and forth to Red Deer, because that's the main hospital that they're
mm-hmm.
have their daughter in right now. Coronation Hospital is a hospital there, which is 15-minute drive, but they don't have everything that they need for this little girl.
Yeah.
So we just went through something with Julia in January when she was diagnosed as a diabetic 1.
Mm.
And it just breaks my heart when I see other children out there that are going through a lot of health issues, especially yeah. at a young age like that. And I got talking yeah. to him on the father on the phone yesterday, and we just decided to help them out
mm.
because it just, you have to do the right thing. You know, if you're doing well enough.
If you don't do something, who will, you know?
Yeah. Exactly. And just hit home, you know. Yeah. Christ is pressing on us to do the right thing, and you gotta follow.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Yes, Vince.
Well, it's not quite as profound, but I had a new customer come to me, and she was distraught because she lost all of her data and her computer died, and it was to run her business. So
yeah.
I managed to sell her a new computer,
mm-hmm.
and it was like new.
Mm-hmm.
And she was happy.
You're the man
about
to deal
that.
With.
Thank you.
Amen. Yeah, Christian integrity in all of our dealings, large or small, goes a long way in making a statement that you are a man or woman of your word, and that you have a high level of integrity and values in your life. Let's partake. In 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23, the Apostle Paul says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you." The Lord Jesus, same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. I'm going to offer up a word of prayer for the wine, the grape juice. And if you'll bow your heads with me, Father in heaven, we don't want to move through this experience irreverently, with haste. We want to stop and reflect on what this might mean to us, Lord. This grape juice was given to us as a symbol of your shed blood and the life that is in your blood and what it does, means to us, what it does for us. And we just pray that it would be consecrated now and dedicated to the sacred symbol, emblem of your shed blood and the blessing of it in our lives. And we do this now in Jesus' name, asking, amen. Last open invitation. Are there any other experiences that have happened of recent that you had an opportunity to bless somebody, help enhance the quality of their life? And no, it might sound like you're boasting of the experience, but is something come to mind that it's an encouragement to us as we see how the church members are networking with people in their circle of life? Yes, we have a hand back there. Thanks, Eugene.
I did speak earlier and ask for prayers for my friend Randy, who I had taken care of for 2.5 years. And I didn't want to get into too much detail. But unfortunately, I had to leave the house that I was living in about 7 months ago, and God has used that time to prepare my heart for my future work, which he has been preparing me for quite some time. But unfortunately, Randy has deteriorated quite a bit, and he's been going through a lot of depression and anxiety and suicidal thoughts. And pretty much because of his being handicapped, he hasn't been able to clean his room and whatnot. And I got a chance to pray with him and talk with him and give him a Bible and encourage him. And, you know, the Lord calls us to be like Christ. And I'm sure the Lord wouldn't want Randy to live the way he's living right now. And he's really struggling and once again, I ask that you guys continue to pray for him.
Mm.
Thank you.
I'm glad you're able to be there for him. He sent me some videos of Randy and you're and helping him clean up his room, but he's definitely handicapped and not able to clean up and take care of himself, so that help in his life is certainly special. We have a hand here. Go ahead, give mic so we can just hear. Yeah, we need to. You have to get used to it. Welcome to church.
Okay. Okay, I had a couple of different experiences, I guess. One, during the prophecy seminar, mm-hmm. I was putting out the sign outside, and a fellow worker that I worked with that lives down the street seen me putting the sign out, and he says, I've been seeing your truck here quite a bit, you know, and I said, yeah, and I explained to him what I was doing, and the little sign I made, because we both worked in a carpenter shop, and I, you know, kind of invited him a bit, and then a couple days ago, a fellow worker who's still on the job, he happened to phone me, and then it ended up to be a conference call with this other guy, and this guy that lives down the road, he kept saying about how much I'm going to church and everything like that, you know, to this other fella.
On Saturday at that, too.
Yeah, who goes to church, too. And so he was talking more about me than I was, about God. And
it's a witness.
And then another episode is a gentleman I kind of been helping with a bit of a drinking problem. And he goes to church on a regular basis. The one that you talk about a lot in your prophecy, and but able to share scripture with him and to encourage him to you know, to follow God's way and search and do what is right.
Amen. Amen. Love to hear it. Is there one other? Go ahead. Okay, we've got one hand up here. Joel, you going to say something?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, and then Anne. No, you go ahead, and then Anne's got her hand up, too.
I've got two kind of interesting experiences. One, witnessing to some people, and one of my friends, she's very very Christian. She's coming into the church a lot more, and we're having the opportunity to share a lot of Christian ideas back and forth. Now she does go to church on Sunday, she goes to church a different day, I'm trying to influence, you know, and we're having, it's really being a joy to converse with her. And I have the opposite experience with another person I'm trying to witness to, a friend that I've been friends with a long time, is atheist, just simply trying to open his mind a little bit to the idea, you know. I got a chance yesterday to speak with him a little longer than normal. So usually it's just a quick, you know, I gotta go, you know, it's busy at Costco, so. But yesterday, about 5 minutes, you know, and he was like, yeah, I mean, I'm sure we could speak about this forever. And I said, yeah, man, like, we gotta have dinner, you know, let's hang out, let's talk about it, you know. But in the conversation, he said, you've never been judgmental, you always seem caring, you always seem interested, genuinely interested. And I praise God for him shining through me like that, for somebody that doesn't believe.
Amen. Anne?
I know that working at H&R Block, sometimes people will be open to me over the phone, and I wanted so much to say, I'd like to pray for you. But, you know, my boss was in the cubicle next to it, and I said I was a little bit nervous about it. But somebody else came, and God entered into the office. And I said I was going to pray for this lady, and she said she was going to pray for me. So God entered into that office.
Yeah. it's kind of a sensitive situation, praying for people in a professional environment where you're at work, but you can get away with it. Go for it. Yeah. Amen. Paul continues. He says, after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Wherefore, whoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Let us reflect on that as we close. Just play anything. Something. Take my life and let it be.
communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Amen. Go in peace.
And please do join us downstairs for lunch.